is that indeed, as Mr. Schneider said, that we will have our money much sooner, usually in 5 business days as opposed to 60. It also will help us with any of our collections issues. As you noticed, we still have 3 customers that are on the delinquent bill list that we have continued to work with for much longer than I care to. And so when we get that customer who at 60 days is delinquent in their bill, we now have another alternative for them to give us a credit card payment and take care of that immediately as opposed to hope and pray that they send a check in. We plan to install this equipment, and I would like to test this out for a 6 to 9 month period of time. And I cannot tell you exactly what customers are interested in signing up, but certainly the convenience side of the customers will probably be the biggest users. And our largest customers will probably be some of the other users. The middle range customers will probably not be interested in this solution. We also, just to keep the board fully abreast of things, have had inquiries as we've talked to prospective new customers about whether or not we can take electronic funds transfers as payments. We're not ready or able to go down the path of an electronic funds transfer where they'll wire us payment just yet, but certainly this brings us back up to the 21st century.
Question. So the cost is $300, $400, $500. How about the transaction fees?
They're associated with the transaction, and it would be our plan to calculate those at the end of the year and either do one of two things: roll them back into the tipping fee, which will probably be a penny on the entire tipping fee for all divisions, or evaluate the customers that are indeed using that service and back that into their account.
Can you do that? I know the Supreme Court just had a decision, or no, it wasn't the Supreme Court decision, it was a Salem decision where you can charge a different rate for someone to use a credit card. So if you go in for like the diner and you go, how much is the turkey sandwich? And they say, well, if you use a credit card, it's $8. If you pay cash, it's $7.50. That's permissible now, I think. Okay.
Well, years ago, you could not.
I understand that.
I think that has changed.
I read the paper. I don't know if it was quite right in the paper, but I got that. Now, governments can charge I'm going to call it a convenience fee. It's a service charge. You get your license, you know, they charge you $2. I just paid a ticket in California, $470, $10 service fee. That's how I know about this stuff. But at any rate, here's the way I look at it. For the commercial accounts, the advantage to us is to catch the guy who's not paying us and say, look, put on your credit card. I'm involved in business, I'm not involved in it now. Well, that was helpful.
Can we legally, when they sign the contracts every year, ask them for a credit card or a copy of a credit card? And if they go past 60 days delinquent, can we automatically charge that card?
You're going to get into PCI compliance as soon as you start holding on to credit card information.
Okay, I didn't know, I'm just asking.
Yeah, okay. That don't make sense. So what I'm saying is, that's one advantage I see for us. So if it costs us $3,000 or $4,000 a year for this service and it catches us one delinquent account, it's paid for itself. Secondly, more importantly, is the homeowners. And like myself, I got 4 or 5 tires in my business. I told my guy to get them out of the dump. I don't know. How much does it cost? I don't know. Call down there. And one of the girls said, well, let's give them the credit card. Sell them now. And I don't take credit cards down there. So I think small businesses would use it, and households would use it, and we might get more revenue from it. That's where I would say, if we're going to get more revenue, to me, that's where it's at.
I would object to the first part about the delinquent. The person who's delinquent probably doesn't have any space on his credit card to give you, okay? So that way I would object to that. Number two, again, this is not an item where you say, okay, I think I'll take more trash down there because now I can pay on the credit card. If you know you got to get rid of the tires, you're going to bring the money to pay for it. If we get, this thing's going to cost you probably in excess of 3% of whatever the proceeds are. You know, I know there's a transaction fee, I know this, and you add it all together, you're going to be paying more than 3%. If you're talking about the money you're going to invest because you got it early, you're not going to get 3% on your money. So, you're being a nice guy and you're going to make it, but the reality is, it's going to cost you money to do this.
Is it close to 3%? Is that what the transaction?
When you get done, I would imagine your average ticket has something to do with this, a number of transactions. If they don't know you from Adam when you're first thing, I would think that you're going to be close to 3% by the time you get done. I have a statement here. Merchant Services. And Bob, you probably know about this stuff as well as anybody. But my rate, one of the rates.
So you use it for your business?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because mine is an impulse buying. Mm-hmm. Right? We're talking, okay, this rate is 3.68. That's a commercial non-qualified. But a qualified one, the bulk of what you're seeing, says 1.62 on both the. But there's all kinds of different rates for different credit cards. So when you get done, I can't imagine that you're not going to be giving away at least 3% of your money on this deal. Now, are more people going to use it? Sure. Now I have my credit card, if I get X amount of points, well, rather than send you a check, I think I'm going to go ahead and give you a charge card now. Yeah. So now you're going to increase the number of people that are going to use that are already paying you. Right? Now all you're doing is losing money. I just don't get it. I just don't get it. So that's my 2 cents worth.
So you think it's 2-3%?
Bob, speak up here.
Well, it's based on per ticket average.
An average ticket.
I mean, see, scale.
You've got two sets of entries. One is going to be the homeowner who comes in for $50.
And that's the worst kind of ticket you want, because you want a high average ticket. So if you're going to have the bulk of yours being the homeowner, you're going to drive your rate up.
But here's the different guy is going to do it two ways. One, he brings each load in, which is $400, $500, $600, $800 load, we'll do it. Or at the end of the month, we'll say, how much are you? $15,000? Here, I'll put on my credit card. Mm-hmm. There are the two types of charge.
Look what you just lost.
Pardon?
Look what you just lost.
Oh, I hear you. I'm listening to you.
What about a convenience fee?
Pardon?
The convenience fee or service fee to offset that.
Well, I think that's where we're,
is that legal? Can we,
I think it is.
Well, yeah, the public bodies.
Register your vehicle and see a convenience fee.
Right, exactly. As I understand it, and again, public body can have a convenience fee, which and it's small. Like I said, these guys want these big $15,000 kicks.
Are you at a landfill doing this?
Pardon?
That's
what I understand.
Certainly, if we could impose a fee of 2-3%, then I wouldn't feel so bad. We're going to be real close to even. But I can just see people trying to rack up points on their credit card and say, hey.
I don't know about that because I do it.
They're going to do it all day long.
I do it.
All we're going to do is reduce the amount.
I do it.
You're trying to get this and this, and what's going to happen is all these people here that were paying you before are now going to use the credit card. And the three or four delinquents that you have, they're not going to have any space on their card. Their card is exhausted. If they had money, they'd pay you.
I was about in business a number of years ago where it did pay. You catch a guy, somebody did. Guy give it to you, bounce back. But sometimes you got it. Sometimes you got it.
I don't know. I'm in the middle. I'm torn on. I understand what you're saying, Lou, as far as, us potentially 3-4 grand or $5,000, whatever it is a year. I mean, I understand the other side of being convenient for the residents. The convenience factor is nice. I've been there many times. I forgot, pulled up, forgot to bring checkbook or cash. Or I thought can't use the debit, can't use anything. So, you turn away. I'm sure it happens now where they forget. I don't know. If I do have to agree if there is a way we can potentially charge a service fee. I like the idea of having it as a convenience factor for
I have an idea.
You pay for convenience.
Well, it might be a good idea to table it, and let's go back and sharpen up, see what that service fee is. And the trouble is, if mom and pop comes in, which we want to get people instead of throwing in the backyard to bring it to us. Like me with them now, I'm tired. Like a major. Just take them down there and get them off here. You know? But the homeowner, might do some of the throw something in the backyard. They take it down. So, mm-hmm. I don't know about that. But I'd be willing to vote with the idea of table it and tune up a little bit and see, we'll get a little more information.
Just see the, if we can charge convenience fee, and even if it's possible, how do you even go about keeping track of it? I mean, I guess when somebody uses a credit card.
It does it right when you do it.
I mean, what if I have a $15,000 bill and I gotta pay the credit card, whatever it is, 10, 12, 8%, and then I'm gonna pay the approval authority additional 3% just to use it upfront?
No, it goes right on your cart right at that time.
I know, that's what I mean. Am I willing to pay an additional $400 or $500 just to use it at that point?
Well, you paid it $400 or $500, or we paid it for it.
Well, that's what I mean, that's what I'm thinking. I mean, are people gonna use it?
Well, at 3%, and we put $1 million on there, that's 30 grand.
Thank you.
Well, that's 30 grand out of our pocket.
Yeah, I'm a little slow in the draw, but I can do that much.
But I mean, that's what I mean, if we have a waste management, for example, if they use, and I don't know, say we get.
I don't think they're gonna use it.
I know, say we have $200,000, are they willing to spend, you know, six grand just to use it? I mean, when they have cash.
Well, as you all know, and Melinda can attest to this, a number of years ago, it was required to prepay your. That was the one when it was controlled. And I remember going by the landfill to see 35 trucks lined up, waiting for their payments to go through so they could get through the gate. Is that correct, Linda?
No, 35 trucks.
Well, not here. I'm talking about up the incinerator.
Other landfills, that is correct.
Yeah, right.
I agree. I think we should just, I make the motion to table resolution 11-82. Until we get further clarification and or if there's a way we could charge some type of service fee. And I'll be honest, if it's not 100%, at least we approve 80%. I mean, you know, it gotta be, but, you know, like you just use the example of, you know, we get $1 million charge worth, I mean, that's $30,000, and around here, that's a lot of money.
Okay, moved, you have a second?
Second.
Moved second, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, it's on the table, hopefully next week, or next week, next month, we'll get a better understanding of the matter. Okay, here's a good one here, I hope. Awarding contract for temporary geosynthetic cover. You call that a raincoat. Debbie, you wanna give us a few seconds?
As you heard from our engineer, we did open sealed bids on July 12th. We did have two respondents, Atlantic Lining for $246,831, and Chenango Contracting for $288,450. This is a project we've been looking at. Given the 2009 and 2011 horrendous rainfalls that we've had, this will put a rain cover on the back of cell number 7, which is our most exposed and active phase of the landfill. It has the least amount of what I'll call natural clay cover on it right now, and would be expected to help us reduce with our leachate costs. We are probably one of only two or three landfills in the entire state that do not have a rain tarp on an active phase of the landfill this time.
Okay, and maybe along with this, we could get a, when we talk to these folks, we get our engineer with them to get a schedule. We think it could be done in the earliest 2 months, is that correct?
Yes.
Latest 3 months? So the idea is to get it done before the monsoon, right?
I'll make the motion.
It's moved, can I hear a second?
Second.
Move a second. Any questions on the motion? Hearing none. Move a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. And we have a certification that their funds are available. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Okay. Resolution concerning shared service agreement with Gloucester County.
Fire chief?
Yes. Mr. Chairman, last month, we reported that Gloucester County had contacted us about the purchase of tire chips from our surplus tire pile, and they would like to make sure this is an ongoing opportunity for them should their supplier shortage them like they have. And we've provided a per ton cost of $15 per ton to sell the tires to Gloucester County, which they're very happy to execute a shared service agreement with us.
Okay, the net result of this is that's all found money. Is that
yes,
correct?
Yes, that is.
Tires that, well, we use them for our lining, which we have plenty on this, so, right?
Yes. You'll see when they finish getting put down, that tire pile's gonna be extensively smaller.
Oh, I understand, but we're not gonna sell them to Webster County and then buy them back next week. Yeah, entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Moving second, any question on the motion? Hearing the question, moving second, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those, yeah. Okay, resolution canceling a resolution to support development construction operations with new and energy waste processing facility. Yeah, I guess that's right.
I'll make the motion. That was from last month, correct?
Right, they fell down and she had to.
We're outside of the mileage.
Yeah.
I'll make the motion.
Motion, have a second?
Second.
Moving second, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those, okay, that's done. Okay, resolution adopting policy procedure for OPA request. That's under. Right behind, okay. Purchase of the chips. Policies regarding open public records act. Okay, behind the resolution just adopted. Okay, Debbie, could you give us a, well, before we get started, how this came about? We had some discussion over the last month or two concerning open requests, the time it was taking us to respond, the fact that we've been using our summer interns who were, the idea of hiring them was to help get our old records organized better, records from the utilities authority and old contracts and budgets and so forth. We were working along on that, but then we had to divert those folks' efforts to handle these OPA requests. There was some discussion, and I think the last meeting it was indicated that the executive committee should come up with some ideas. And I guess, Mike, the idea that we came up with, we want to be ahead of the game on this. We want to try to be transparent, get everything out, and hence the camera there, and we'll get to that in a few minutes, so that we can possibly get all this stuff out so there's hardly any need for requests, because everything will be handed out. So, and then we tried to mess with the OPA thing, and our attorney said, don't mess with the OPA thing because it's guided by law. So we said, okay, let's adopt the standard OPA regulation, which you can't change, and then adopt another policy which goes above and beyond, where we would get a lot of this stuff out into the public. People would need to use the efforts to use the OPA regulation. So, Debbie, with that in mind.
Okay, your policy and procedures are pretty clear. The purpose of this is to basically affirm the Salem County Improvement Authority's intentions to comply with and exceed the requirements of the Open Public Records Act. It does talk specifically about the roles of the board, which is to appoint a records custodian that will provide staff support, equipment, and other resources as needed. The Improvement Authority will then require the records custodian to collect fees from the requesters are permitted under OPA, but they are limited to the copy cost, medium conversion cost, and any special service fee associated with that specific request. It outlines procedures for the development of the OPA form, which we already have, and the distribution thereof. And also talks about how much time the Improvement Authority will dedicate to a open public records request, basically free of charge. After which a special service fee will go into place. And then also discusses the instructions that are to be provided to all employees of the Improvement Authority, whether they are the records custodian or not, in regards to the timeliness and need to respond to those requests in a defined period of time. Therefore, staff will be given priority attention to the documents requested. And then the solicitor is also going to be available to the records custodian should there be a need for redaction or counsel on that. And that we shall also follow and abide by all the other statutes, regulations, and directives of the case law. And I'm happy to answer any questions. We also have some information from the attorney relative to the charges and case law on inspection of documents. Any questions?
It'll be a point of reference.
You've already taken care of that. I'm in the records.
So would the open request would get what they normally would get, but now you're telling them that it'll be available to get the videotape?
Well, that's not part of this.
That's just standard Oprah request, rules and regulations, I guess you would say.
And the next step is over and above Oprah.
So I guess I don't know, even though it's a law, I guess I don't know if we ever formally adopted a policy, so we're adopting, so I make the motion 11-86 to adopt the policy and procedures for Oprah requests.
Okay.
Second.
Motion made second. Any questions on the motion? Hearing none, move to second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, here's the next item. Now we'll get to the camera part of it.
Okay.
Yeah, please.
As a follow-on to that discussion on Oprah requests, we talked about providing additional information through our website. For those of you who are not familiar, there is a new statutory requirement that will take place in 2013 for public entities that will be required to have a website or to post information on a website. We've done an internal review of our existing website to determine where we have compliance with that future statute and where we have some gaps, and have decided that it's in the organization's interest to have a website posting procedure so that people are very clear about what goes on the website, when things go on the website, and what the channel is to get things posted to the website. This policy, again, applies to the employees. It speaks to the designation of a website host, a website manager, and a web manager, all of which you have right now, okay, so there's no change there. And with the executive director and the webmaster collaborating to ensure that the website is maintained, updated, and accessible. All requirements to post the information shall be subject to the approval of the executive director, so we don't have just anybody posting anything on the website. Documents from the monthly meetings are going to be posted according to the following schedule under normal circumstances. I would say normal circumstances, that certainly depends on the website being up, that there be no IT problems or anything like that. The meeting agendas will have a draft copy posted by noon of the day of the regular meeting, with a final copy posted 5 business days following the meeting. The board minutes, a final copy posted in later than 60 days following final approval and adoption, and a final copy of the minutes for any special meeting posted, again, later than 60 days following final approval and adoption. The SCI meeting schedule is posted with the notice setting the date, time, and location with the agenda, no later than 15 business days following our annual meeting or the meeting in which those board dates are approved, and a copy of the public notice, which is done within 48 hours of those meetings. A copy of the final audit will be posted no later than 60 days following approval and adoption by this SCIA board. The budget, the introduced budget, will be posted no later than 15 days following the SCIA board approval. Amended budgets, again, posted no later than 15 business days following the SCIA's approval. And final budget, being posted no later than 60 days following the SCI's final approval and adoption. And that shall replace the introduced and amended versions of the budget, so we get the full budgets there. The SCI admission will be posted no later than 60 days following any and all revisions by the SCIA. That is already up there. We have contract information for persons who exercise day-to-day supervision or management over some or all of the operations. That is something that's not posted on our website, but will be posted no later than 30 days following any and all revisions and updates by the SCIA board. Fiscal reports, we talked about the audit. Rules and regulations, any rules and regulations that the SCIA board determines to be in the best interest of the residents will be posted no later than 30 days following revisions or adoptions of those. And then attorneys, advisors, consultants, and any other person, firm, business, partnership, or corporation which receive any remuneration of $17,000 or $17,500 or more during the preceding fiscal year will also be posted on the website, and we will also post those no later than 30 days. Lastly, the SCIA shall, in its sole discretion, cause to be posted any other information deemed pertinent and necessary to further the organization's missions and goals, and the solicitor will be available to the executive director and webmaster on an as-needed basis for any questions.
The only final one, I guess, is regarding the videotaping.
Videotape. Videotape. The record of the
Well, there's several things. We're going to have the packet that we get a copy on the desk so people can review that. Is that correct?
It is there now.
Right, but I mean that I don't see that written in our policy here.
That is not something that's posted on the website.
Okay, yeah, but do you have it later on, this is part of our policy?
No, this is website posting.
Okay. All right, well, let's get the website posting, and then we go into that. Is that fair? Okay.
Any new cost for this?
Pardon?
Any new cost for this?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
How much we talk about?
One thing, there's the first thing is, to me, it's too long to put it on our 60 days, okay? But I don't think we can do it any better, because we have to do it in between other work. We don't have somebody, a full-time person here that can...
Well, and it's a state requirement also, and some of the towns that don't even have websites, they're, now the state's gonna require them to have a website and post it, so it's gonna cost.
Some of this stuff will be required in the future, so we'll be just to jump ahead of it. But I think our only alternative is to try it and see what it takes. And, you know, ideally, you would put this stuff up in 10 days, you know, but anybody hanging around, you know what I mean? So we have to do it.
Where it makes sense, we're trying to internalize some of the routine posting by using staff. Currently, right now, our webmaster is contracted to only provide updates once a month for cost efficiency. So those things that are not considered times of the essence will continue to be posted on a monthly basis. But we are looking to internalize some of the things like, you know, regular agenda. But again, this organization was not created to do those sorts of things.
Well, say all of a sudden it's $3,000 or $4,000 a month to run that, where would the money come from?
Come from our budget.
It's not, we're putting a budget for this year, all right?
We have a running for web posting, we should do web posting and web support.
Yeah, I mean, we can't afford that. It can't cost that, but that's why we have to attempt to do this and see if we can work it into our, and get each individual trained to get this stuff together. It's not gonna be done overnight, and I'll tell you, we adopt this, be prepared, something ain't gonna get done quite in time. And our executive director will tell us that and say, I couldn't get this done on time because, and we'll either have to say, well, relax the regulation, or find a way to do it. But, you know, we'll be certainly ahead of the curve on it. Some of these things are going to be required in a year or two anyway. So you might as well get in practice. And, you know, that's why I look at it. And we'd be, you know, we'll be the most transparent organization in South Jersey. And then we can challenge others to be as transparent, you know. That's my feeling on it. Anybody else?
I agree. I say we move forward and see how we go. I mean, I know we discussed it last month with some members of the public about, and I agree, and I know you said it. I mean, I feel the same way. Whatever I get here, everybody else should get, minus any attorney client information. I mean, there's no secrets here. I mean, so why not post it on the website, and then they'll probably actually, hopefully, posting on the website will cut down on some of the open requests.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So you spend more hours doing that and less hours with DOPA requests, so I guess it all evens out when it's said and done. But, you know, and that's why the book is here. I mean, anybody can look through and whatever.
Okay. I'll
make the motion.
Moved. Your second?
Second.
Moved and second. Any question on the motion? Any question on the motion? Moved and second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, let the record show is unanimous vote. Okay, now, as far as the meeting is concerned, not written here, I said to you that I thought we might have it. There'll be a packet placed there. Is it over there? That's that blue thing? Okay. So anybody come a little early. One of the problems is these packets are not done sometimes until 10, 15 minutes before the meeting, adding stuff, changing stuff, so forth. Also, we're going to lay out, I would recommend that we lay out 4 copies of the bill list. They're appropriately stamped proposed bill lists, because we don't know that they're going to be approved. We assume they are, but sometimes they're not. And we could lay them out. So that would be 2 items that probably eliminate some open requests. Now the camera. The idea of that would be that we would start that thing up at the beginning of the meeting, let it go through the whole meeting, and then post it on the website. Now the question is, how post, how quick can we get it posted to the website? Debbie, what do you, what would you say?
I will let you know after we have our first stint with our new webmaster.
We're thinking along the lines of YouTube, or not YouTube, streamline it right from, I know we talked about potentially even, I know there's some towns, there is a channel, I think, in Salem County that's dedicated for Comcast, for the meetings. I know Gloucester County has actually some towns that you could actually put on Channel 9, or 7, or 5, whatever it is, and actually watch. I've watched East Greenwich and other townships, so we thought about, but then we don't, you know, we're not gonna spend a ton of money for, you know, we videotape it, we post it on there, and anybody could watch, so if you look at the minutes and there was some discussion on something, you can refer to the video and see what was talked about. So I support it. I don't know how the rest of the board feels, but I think it's a good idea.
Entertain a motion.
I'll make the motion that we start taping our meetings, and once we hear back from Debbie about how long, or shortly thereafter, we post the, on the website.
But my concern on videotape, now of course when it's on the, they have to capture it off, they have to capture it, but you know, you can take a videotape, but editing, make some statements, put it out. It's very hard, it would not be easy for them to capture it off of the screen there, but it can be done. And Michael Burke could say, jump in the river, and then add something else to it, next thing you know, it doesn't. That's my concern with that. And they could be used politically also, I'm sure. Right? But it's not everybody that can do that. But
well, I mean, we'll control the main one. Anybody who has a copy, they can open it and get a copy.
Well, that makes you real nervous now. Yeah. You're going to give somebody a copy of the thing.
Why?
Oh, my God, if you give them a copy, it's so easy to edit something up.
That's the
and
law.
Take something out, right, and yeah, make the statement not be what it was.
That's the law. The law is...
Well, then I would have... Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine.
I'm I mean, I've been involved in this. We would have videos in the past. That's the law. If you video it, anybody can get it.
No. It's a government record. That becomes a government record. It's subject to a process.
But the fact that you have the full tape, you can go back to the truth.
Well, the truth is one thing, okay? Perception is another, right?
Or once somebody fabricates, they edit, and they
edit. Once they put something out there, the damage is done. You can't put the back in the can. It's done.
You can file charges against that person.
Well, you can do that too.
Oh, right? Yeah.
But the damage is done, right?
Well, I mean, it's done all over the state. I mean, we won't be the first. We'll be the first probably in this region to do it. We certainly won't be the first in New Jersey to do it. That's a fact. Okay? Yeah, we know about editing. I've learned that. People can do some tricky stuff with it.
In my opinion, I feel as though we should move forward with it. And if someone is that desperate to grab a meeting and change it around, so be it. I mean, what are you going to do? I mean, you can get anything on the internet nowadays, so... It really doesn't matter. I mean, they could swing it this way or say that, and you see it all the time on the presidential ads. You say one thing in a speech, they take this word and that word and this word, and they put together that says something. I mean, they do it. I mean,
Is that a form of a motion?
I make the motion. We start
videotaping,
authorizing our meetings, and post it shortly thereafter on the website.
Second. Question of the motion? Hearing no question. Move and second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed.
Opposed. One opposed.
I'm waiting for that.
Okay. And obviously, let's be fair about it. It's going to be a little hiccups here. And, you know, so we're, first month or two, we're going to be a little learning process. And we'll try to figure out how we could stop that from being manipulated. That's a good question. But I know it can be done. I've had some experience with it myself. Okay, so that's that. Now we go into the correspondence. Okay, now the one. The one question we had, now we got the letter from the freeholder director, and is that put to bed? We got this letter saying for us to cease and desist.
It was actually from their attorney.
Well, I don't think it was. Adam, who did we get it from? We got it from their attorney.
It was written by Ross.
But it said that the freeholder board directed us to cease and desist from doing economic development?
Yes.
Okay. And when we received that, the executive committee gave it to Adam. We said, Adam, what does this mean? And Adam said, what? Adam, tell us what.
I said, I said, I don't know really what it does, what it means, because I'm looking at the letter right now. Advice Skia to cease economic development activity. My reaction was, what is economic development activity? It's sort of an ambiguous term. It's it covers a large variety of different potential things. It could potentially cover every single thing the improvement authority does. So my suggestion was to request more information with regard to what the freeholder specifically meant with regard to redevelopment activity and those specific activities or activity that the freeholders were requesting that we cease from performing. And that letter was sent out on July 10th to Mr. Levitsky on behalf of the freeholder board.
Have we heard back?
No, no response.
Okay, and my question to you was, I said, does that mean that the potential customer that we have wants to build a new building in Salem County, we should immediately tell them, stop, we don't help you no more? And I think you said, you don't know that it means that.
Again, it's the letter, the content, the letter is so vague that I don't really know what it means.
Well, did we determine what the freeholder board voted on?
Well, I know what they voted on by reading the paper. Is that your...
Well, no, because it said the freeholder board said cease.
Correct. Oh, you're looking at this letter. What did they...
Yeah, so I immediately called one of the freeholders up. He said, I didn't know what he was talking about. I said, when was this discussed at the freeholders? He said, I don't know what you're talking about. Okay, and I think you called a freeholder, right?
I spoke with, actually, around 5:30 on July 3rd, we received this letter probably around 4:15 on July 3rd, emailed or hand carried over, and I actually called Freeholder Cross, and he at that time told me that he had no idea about the letter. I spoke with Freeholder Bobbitt, Freeholder Timmerman, and they were also unaware of the letter. But more importantly, in my opinion, regardless of whether the letter was sent or not, I mean, that's something the county needs to worry about on their end. We have our own problems. I feel as though they should have had time to potentially schedule a meeting. And to be honest with you, and you know, maybe you can enlighten on this. And if there was something that you guys did not think we were doing correctly, or you guys have a different vision for the county, or something that you guys seem that we could do better, or you guys think you can do a better job, maybe there's ways we can assist you. Maybe there's ideas you have. And rather than sending a letter to say cease with economic development activities, I would have thought the grown-up thing to do, or since we're all supposed to be in this together and we're for the people, would be, let's give them a call. And at the courtesy, just to give them a call and say, hey, look, we don't want you to do it anymore. We have this great plan and we're gonna do it. And just, you guys, if we need some bonding done, that's fine, and we can bond, and I'm okay with that. I don't have any hard feelings, because there's a new majority now, and if they have certain ideas that they want to proceed with, I'm okay with that. But I just thought a letter to cease, and then nobody can find the contract now that says, so it's all kind of fishy, and I think a meeting, in my opinion, for all of us to sit down like grown-ups and discuss this would have been the right thing to do. And that's just my opinion. You know, you might have a different opinion. I respect your opinion, and that's why I'm just curious on where the freeholder board currently is on this.
Well, it's not a matter of my opinion, and I can't speak for the entire freeholder board.
Okay.
The words of the letter may be vague, but I believe that they were trying to accomplish something that Freeholder Cross made mention of in the public meeting last week.
And what was that?
I can't remember his statement exactly.
Okay, I'm not going to quote you on it.
Yeah,
I understand.
It was something to do with, it wasn't a contract, it was an agreement.
Okay, I understand.
and of which we could not find. At least we could not find it. Now, you have a copy of it, I don't know. But the idea was we wanted to, he believed that the letter was to be written to officially notify SCIA that we were not going to fund the economic development.
Okay.
And so, you know, and I'm paraphrasing his statement. I don't know exactly what it was he said. And I am not going to speak for the entire Freeholder Board. I have made some notes here. I think that there's some correctness in what you're saying, that we need to sit down and have some dialogue.
And I agree, and I feel, and whether there's agreement or not agreement, you know, obviously under the statute, if someone were to read our statute, you know, we have the authority to do it regardless. I mean, we're not gonna do economic development. You guys do it. We don't have millions of dollars coming in this county to do that. We're not going to play those kind of games. I don't care politics or not. That's why I figure we sit down at a table and we just talk about it. And you know what? You guys may have some amazing ideas that we don't know about. And I wish you guys would enlighten us on it. And same with Freeholder Cross. I mean, if he had no idea about this, but then he makes a comment at the Freeholder meeting, it's just very confusing on what's going on. And that's why
I don't want to put words in his mouth. Yeah. I think that what he had no idea about is the verbiage in the solicitor's letter. Okay. That's what I think he had no idea about.
All right. No, I understand. That's why I'm just, because when I called him, he was unaware of the letter at the time. And, you know, and that's fine. I mean, I understand. And there's committees that you guys have, and you're also authorized certain things. But, you know, when it states that the board has chosen freeholders, and to be honest with you, I don't think any of us here have time to play letter back and forth games, because you know who wins out is, no offense, the lawyers. You know, I send a letter to your lawyer, you send a letter to my lawyer, it's $150, $300 every time, when we all, the seven of you and the five of us, can sit down and cost anybody any money. So that's where I would hope you would take back, and I'm sure you will, to the Freeholder Board and say, let's schedule a meeting.
I will take it back to the admin committee and recommend that at a workshop we invite you in.
That's what I would like.
And here's where it goes, where a real problem arises. My understanding from what I've been told, and I wasn't there, so I'll throw it in at the meeting, the Freeholder director said it was a misunderstanding, and as you said, it was really that you weren't going to fund our efforts. So I'll accept that as the explanation. But here's the problem. That article that went in the local paper was in the New York Star Ledger, okay? So now, we're trying to get a new customer down here, build a 100,000 square foot building. He said, what's going on down here? Don't they, what, these people are kindergarten employers down here? Now, let's stay away from there. And I know from people who are relocating, and I've been an economic development director for many years, okay? People in business don't like to get involved with people who are going to throw stuff in the paper. They say, stay away from there. These are amateurs. And, you know, if we get together in a room, get organized, that's fine. Come out with a statement so that we get the confidence of the commercial public, the industrial public, so they feel comfortable about coming here. And also that the citizens of the county get a feeling of confidence. I have some people joking about it, you know. Well, there, if some of the citizens of the county are joking about it, some potential customers are joking about it. So that's where I think where the problem lies. And again, say, it only got in Salem County, it's controlled. Well, the New York Star Ledger. That's not good. But anyway, there we are. Any other?
Just one point clarification.
Yeah.
Indeed, that did occur on Thursday last week. Mr. Smith and I had a meeting with a very serious business potential client interested in moving here from Delaware. And in the course of that conversation, the discussion said, well, I'm interested in knowing how local politics is, because it does not look like your local politicians are on the same page, and why would I want to come to Salem County as opposed to Gloucester and Hamilton? So
I think it's pretty obvious we're not on the same page. That's pretty obvious.
That there are real life examples.
Well, it's not obvious to me. It's obvious right now because you said it. I didn't know that before today.
Well, you're talking to a guy that's relatively a novice here, and quite frankly, I'm not doing it for political reasons. I'm doing it because I believe the public needs to be served in the proper way. I have nothing for or against personally anyone in this room or anything that this organization does. I want to do the right thing for all the stakeholders in Salem County. And I think, you know, if we can sit down and agree, that's what we want to do. But that's what we have to agree on, that it's all the stakeholders that should benefit and not just a few. When I was elected to represent 15 municipalities and 65,000 people. I'm going to represent them all, not a select few.
And no disagreement from me, that's why I'm here, yeah.
That's why we thought a meeting would have taken place by now. I mean, we had, with the addition of Pete and the addition of Lou, I mean, I'm
well,
sure...
Well, we have some budget challenges, yeah.
I understand.
And we're also planning a strategic planning meeting to try to determine what direction the county should take.
Mm-hmm. Well, how could you have a strategic planning meeting without having input from us? That'd be interesting.
I think we have to make some decisions as to what we want to do, whether we are going to take the role of economic development or whether we're going to have someone else do it. But I think currently, you know, that's a matter of discussion. You know, again, I don't want to speak for the Freeholder Board because no decisions have been made. But these are things that we've been working through and planning, and the strategic planning session is scheduled for August 1st.
So you say we, meaning the Freeholder Board?
The Freeholder Board has agreed to have a strategic planning meeting on August 1st.
Okay. But they have agreed to...
We've only agreed to have a strategic planning meeting, and at that point, we will determine the direction that the county is going to take.
But how could you make that decision without our input? I don't understand that. That is very difficult for me. I mean, here we are, we've been years in this, and we have a report.
Well, I could very simply say, we don't necessarily need you, but I'm not speaking for the Freeholder Board here.
So when you say we, you?
That's why I really don't want to get into this conversation. We are having a strategic planning meeting to discuss the direction of the county.
Without our input?
Based on. Well, we don't need, we're looking for everyone's input.
So you
all stakeholders of Salem County, and you're welcome to come. It's a public meeting. You're welcome to come and give your input. As a matter of fact, there's a form on the county website asking for input. So,
that's great. I didn't realize that. That was the first I heard this. So, we can come and give our program.
Well, we have a facilitator for the strategic planning session. We are looking for input on written forms. I'm not saying that you have opportunity to share in the discussion because we have a facilitator who's going to direct that, but you certainly can make your suggestions on the forms that we have available.
Okay, so we're an organization that has spent hundreds of thousands of dollars a year, 5-10 years, involved in this effort, and you're going to make a decision without our input. That's very interesting. Okay, I have a problem with that, but something I can do about it. Anybody else have any question, anything to add to this? Okay, what else we got here? Anything else on the... Oh, I'm sorry. There we go. Okay, we have a list of correspondence here.
I'll make a motion. Will you receive and file correspondence?
Second.
Moving second. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Okay, what's next on our agenda? I'll tell you what I might be able to...
Chairman, you do have one brief executive session matter.
Okay. We didn't finish this because this is the problem we have in this meeting. Do we want to, does this executive session require any action on our part?
No.
Okay, so we could have the public comment, we could adjourn our regular meeting, go into closed session, and
we should open to public.
Open it to the public. Mm-hmm. Finish that with the closed session. Finish it up so the public can leave. No, full well.
Taking any action after executive session. Correct.
Okay. Is that okay? Everybody in agreement with that?
I make the motion. We open the meeting to the public.
So moved.
Okay. Move second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. If each person would stand up, give their name, ask one question, or put one.